Hello, church family, those visiting, and even those online. We'd like to welcome you to Philadelphia Christian Church. Hello, Christians. If you need a little more God in your life and Sunday service wasn't quite enough for you, be sure to join us on Tuesday at 7 p.m. for Bible study and Monday through Friday at 12 p.m. for noonday prayer and every Thursday at 6 for the School of Prayer. Hello, brothers of Philadelphia. We'd like to welcome you to the men's group. Let some of that iron sharpen iron. Join us this Monday at 7 p.m. at the Pine Street location.
Ladies' Bible study will be this Monday. Come and join us as we come together as Sisters United.
And if you'd like to join us for the nursing home ministry, meet us at Magnolia Estates at 145 today.
If you're looking to be plugged into the church, you've been visiting for a while, and you feel that this is your church home, come and join us at the new members class. It will be Wednesday, January 25th at 7 p.m. We look forward to seeing you there.
And those are your announcements. You know what time it is now. Get on your feet. It's worship time.
Hallelujah, hallelujah. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us
rejoice and be glad.
Come on, give God some praise for another awesome day. Man, it's a blessing to see y'all. A lot of y'all came here in this cold weather. I know y'all love Jesus. Hallelujah. This is amazing. Hallelujah. How many of y'all ready to make his name great today? We serve a great God, and he's greatly to be praised this morning. Amen. Oh, God, we love you, Lord God. We're going to make your name look good, Lord God. We ask, you said that if we lift your name up from the earth, that you would draw all men. This is our prayer today, that you would draw us into your presence, draw us closer to you, meet our needs, Lord God. We desire you this morning, Lord God. Our hearts long for you like the deer that panted for the water. We need you today. We want you today, Lord God. Have your way in this place. And the church say,
amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, put your hands together like this.
Let it be known that our God reigns, our God reigns. We lift you up, up. Let it be known that love has come and love has won. We lift you up, up. Thank you.
everybody. Clap, 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 clap.
We lift your name up higher and higher. We shout your name now louder and louder.
Here we go.
We lift your name
higher and higher.
Higher and higher.
We shout your name now.
We shout
now,
your name now
louder.
Louder and louder.
We lift your name
higher and higher.
We shout your name
we
now,
shout your name now louder.
Louder
and louder.
We lift your name,
we your name
higher and higher.
Higher and higher.
We shout it out.
We shout it out. Let it be known that our God saves,
our God reigns.
We lift
you up,
we lift you up, up.
Let it be known that love has won,
love has won, love has won.
We lift you up,
we lift you
somebody
up.
Somebody cry,
oh.
Spirit. Our God is greater.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah, Lord. We worship you the highest this morning, oh God. And there's nobody like you, oh God. Oh God, you're worthy to be praised this morning.
Oh, water you turned into wine. Open the eyes of the blind. There's no one like you, none like you. Into the darkness you shine, and out of the ashes we rise. There's no one like you, none like you.
God is greater, our God is stronger. Lord, you are higher than any other. Our God is healer, awesome in power. Our God is.
Oh, there's nobody like our God.
No one like you, Jesus.
Nobody like you.
Lord,
there's no one like Lord, we searched all over.
None like you.
Come on, declare that today. Our God
is greater.
Our God
is stronger.
Lord, you are higher
than any other. Our God is
not your healer.
Awesome in power. Our God is
Lord, your healer,
awesome in power. Our God,
yeah. sometimes you just gotta talk to your struggle. There's nobody like you, oh Lord. And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand again?
If our God is for us, then who could ever stop
Nothing
us?
Can stop us?
And if our God is with us, then what can stand again? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand again? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand again? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand again? And if our God is for us, then who could ever stop us? And if our God is with us, then what can stand? Our God is healer, awesome in power, our God.
Oh, glorious will be that day, where every knee will bow and every tongue will confess. Oh, that you are. God, glory in this place. Hallelujah.
He's great. Oh God, we desire you tonight, today. There's no other place you'd rather be but in your presence, Lord God. Say, I've been changed.
I've been changed.
Say, I've been healed.
Healed.
I've been free. Delivered.
Delivered.
Say, I found joy.
I found joy.
I found peace. And we thank you for your grace.
Grace.
And favor.
And favor.
I've been changed. In the presence of the Lord. Anybody been free? Grateful for your grace and favor.
Forgiven.
Hallelujah. No more chains.
No more chains.
He's a chain breaker. Come Come on, no more fear. Cast out in the name of Jesus. My past. Somebody speaking today. Say it's over.
It's over.
And right now. You've been waiting for this morning. This morning, don't let it pass you by.
Be by.
And we say,
I won't go back. I can't go back to the way it used to be before your presence came and changed.
On a blessing this year. Hallelujah. How many are waiting on a healing this year?
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. I want y'all to claim it. Just take 10 seconds just to praise him right now. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We need you today. Hallelujah. Lord, whatever you do in this season, don't do it without me. Don't do it without me. How many of y'all just got crying today? Say, Lord, whatever you do it in this season. Don't do it without me. Come on, I want y'all to help us out. Say, Lord, Say, don't do it without me.
Don't do it without me.
Don't do it, Jesus.
Hey. Don't do it without me.
Lord, we need a healing. We need a healing.
Oh,
oh Lord.
If
you're healing, I know he's healing.
Healing in this season.
Somebody say, don't do it without me.
Don't do it without me.
Come on. Like you mean it this morning, say,
don't do it without me.
How many of y'all need a blessing this morning? Somebody say,
Lord, if you're blessing,
he's blessing us.
Blessing in this sea.
But I need a blessing. Say, Lord,
Lord,
Lord, if he's blessing, huh?
Blessing in,
and I know he's blessing.
Please.
To me during worship, because every now and then something will stick out to me, amen, that really have something on it, like an anointing, an unction on it. And it's the words, amen, want to be included, amen. Amen, want to be included. Because I believe in 2017, God is doing some things, amen. Some blessings, some breakthrough, amen. Some healings, amen. Some prosperity, hallelujah. Some businesses, amen. Some doors going to open for people, amen, that never would open before, amen. 2017 is that year, amen. But God want to know who want to be included in that, amen. Who want to be included, all right? Are we just going to let the opportunity just pass us by? Do we want to be involved? Amen. Included, involved. Do we want to be instrumental? Amen. Whatever you're doing, God, if you're opening businesses, if you're making new records and praise and worship, and God, whatever you're doing, Lord God, if you're reviving, God, if you're waking people up, whatever you're doing, God, don't do it without me. Amen. It reminds me of that thief on the cross. Amen. He said, Lord, I know you're going to enter in your kingdom, but he said, Lord, just remember me, Lord God. Remember me. Pass me not, O gentle Savior. Hear my humble cry. While on others thou art passing, do not pass me by. Come on. Is there anybody's prayer here this morning? Hallelujah. Don't do it. Don't do it without me. Because the truth be told, God's going to do what God's going to do. It's not a question. He's going to get it done. And the fact of the matter is, he will get it done with us or without us. Hey, anybody hear me up in here? So you want to make sure to get yourself in a position. Hey, get your heart, hallelujah, in a frame of mind where you want to be a part of what God is doing. You want to be involved. You want to be instrumental. Hey, you want God to not do it without you. God, in the mighty name of Jesus, God, we thank you that you are an inclusive God, Father God, that you don't seek to exclude us. You want to use us. You want to bless us. The Bible says that you delight in the prosperity of your people. It's not a question of your will wanting us there. You want us there. The only question this morning is if we really want to be there. And Father, this morning we answer the clarion call and we say, yes, Lord. We say, yes, Lord. We say, yes to your will, yes to your way. We say, yes to your plan. We say, yes to your blessings. Yes to your prosperity. Yes to your healings. Yes to your revival. Yes to new business opportunities. Yes to new anointings. Yes, Lord God, to your will. Yes to your way, Lord God. Yes, Lord God, we say yes. So we pray that you don't do it without us, God. We on board. And Father, we pray if there's anything that would hinder us or stop us, that, Lord, you would cut us loose from it, God. And you would allow us to lay aside every sin and the weight that would easily beset us, God, and press on, hallelujah, looking to Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Bless us, O King, as a people individually, God, to move with you, King. Bless us, God, hey, as a family, God, husbands, wives, children, to move with you, God. Help us, Lord God, as a church, O King, to move with you, Lord God. Help us, Lord, as a Hebrew nation, Lord, to move with you, Lord God. We don't want you to pass us up, O King. We want you to do it, but please include us too. Now, Father, we pray that you bless this service, God. And you bind the devil from hindering us in this service. We plead the blood of Jesus over everybody here. And Father, there's a greatest thing this morning that you're doing in this season that people should really be asking you to not do it without them. Because Father, in this season, you're saving right now. You're saving, Lord. You're saving in this season. And my prayer this morning is that somebody would say, Lord, if you're saving in this season, don't do it without me. Oh God, don't save nobody without me. Don't save my neighbor and save people on the front row and the back row without saving me. So God, I pray you save somebody this morning. Jesus' mighty name we pray. Brian, we're going to sing that, just that one little part. Lord, if you're saving in this season. Hallelujah. We're going to just do that. Then we're going to get to our business here.
Lord, if you're saving, saving in this season,
woo!
Please don't do it without me.
Oh, that's good. That's good. Come on.
Don't do it without me.
Let's do that again. Let's, can we do that again, Lord?
Lord, if you're saving, saving in this season,
woo!
Please don't do it without me.
Hey, come on.
Don't do it without me.
Lord, if you're redeeming, let's try that.
Lord, if you're redeeming, redeeming.
If you're setting anybody free, God. If you're breaking chains and shackles, God.
Don't do it
without me. Don't pass me by. Set me free too.
Don't do it without me.
Can we do providing? Can we do providing?
Lord, he providing, providing.
Oh God, if you're blessing people, if you're blessing them, providing for them,
please, God,
please. Don't leave me broken, busted, God. Come on. If you're giving dreams and businesses, don't do it. Let's do that one more time. Hey, somebody want this.
Lord,
don't leave me in debt. Hey,
providing,
hey, if you're providing, Jesus,
providing,
come on,
season,
open the windows of heaven,
please
God,
don't do it, me.
Don't do it, God, don't do it,
don't do it without
one more beat, one more beat, y'all doing good, reviving, Lord, if you're reviving,
Lord,
hey, if you're reviving your church, if you're reviving your people, if you're gathering, hey, please, God.
Please don't do it without me.
Not without me, Lord God. Not without me.
Don't do it without me.
Come on, give the Lord some glory in this house. Give the Lord some glory. Give the Lord some glory. Hallelujah. Come on, hug a few people and tell them the Lord won't pass you by. The Lord won't pass you by. He won't pass you by. While he blessing, he gonna bless you too. While he blessing, he gonna bless you too. He won't pass you by. He won't pass you by. You gonna get yours.
He won't pass you by.
He won't pass you by. You gonna get yours. You will get yours. He won't pass you by.
Hey.
Come on, Jesus. He won't do it. Hey. He won't pass you by. Thank you, Lord. Included. Involved. Instrumental. Hallelujah. Thank you, Daddy. Oh, that was right on time. That was right on time. Gracie, can you grab my Bible? Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Thank you, Bertie. Don't do it, Lord. Don't do it. My God. I love that. Well, saints, we just want to welcome you, amen, on this Sunday morning. It's cold, but it's beautiful, amen. Hallelujah. Welcome you here to Philadelphia Christian Church this morning, amen. And we got a few things we want to do, and y'all know me, I'll usually forget the tide, so I better go ahead and get it right out of the way now. Amen. And so Philadelphia is offering time. Amen. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. And just go ahead and prepare yourself for tithes and offerings. Hallelujah. Ushers, y'all can come on up to the front. Hallelujah. And one way to make sure that if the Lord is providing and blessing in the season, one way to make sure you include it, amen, is to be faithful in tithes and offerings. Amen. Hallelujah. And that's what we want to do. And so, saints, hallelujah, giving is very important to the church. It keep the church going. Keep all the bills paid in the church. Keep, amen, the gospel going forth. And God's people being gathered. And so we're going to do that. Hallelujah. And we got one dedication this morning. So, family, y'all get ready because we're going to do this right after the tithe. Amen. Let's see. 8 a.m. service. No babies to be dedicated. All right. We're going to just do a 10:30 service. All right. So, brothers, if y'all can give me some music so the people of God can come and worship him in the tithe. Hallelujah. People of God, y'all can come even now. Amen. If you prefer to give online or to give through your phone, you can text, amen, and give. We got the number up there for you. Amen. Hallelujah. You can, and it's very easy. You type that number in, put your information in, and all you got to do is send the amount, and that's a blessing. Amen. You can also give through our websites, whether it's Philadelphia PCC or Expounding Truth Ministry. You can do that. Amen. Whatever's best for you. Amen. But the answer is to give. Hallelujah. That's the answer. That's the answer this morning. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And I pray a hundredfold blessing on everybody that's giving. I pray a hundredfold blessing. This is part of worship right here, y'all. This is part of worship right here. This is part of worship. Y'all actually worshiping the Lord. Hallelujah. Y'all actually worshiping the Lord. This is part of worship here. This is part of worship. Hallelujah. Good to see you, Brother Kevin. Love you, brother. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. 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 So happy y'all here. Love y'all so much. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord God. Hallelujah. God has been good to us, saints. Amen. He's been good. Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Stretch forward your hands and we're going to pray a blessing over these tithes and offerings. Most High God, we thank you so much for providing for us. We thank you during this cold, we had a roof over our head, Lord God. We had a bed to sleep in, Lord God. We had covers to put upon us, oh God. And it's all because of you, Lord God. You are Jehovah Jireh, our provider. And as a token of our appreciation unto you, O King, we give back to you right now, God. We give you the tithe. We give you the offering, God. Not because we expect anything back, Lord God, because you've done enough for us already, God. But we give it to you because you're worthy, Lord God. You deserve it, Lord God. And we say thank you, Father God. And now to be true to your word, you said if we would give, it'd be given back to us. Pressed down, shaken together, running over. God, not that we need it, God, but do it so you could be true and every man be a liar, God. So give unto your people a hundredfold blessing in return. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Amen, amen, amen. Come on, give God some glory. Hallelujah. Ushers, y'all can follow Minister Ant out. Hallelujah. And we got a few announcements for you this morning. Amen. But I guess while we're doing the announcements, you can just take your Bibles and turn with me to Acts chapter 5. Acts 5 and in verse 17. Hallelujah. And we got a few announcements this morning. I guess to start off, amen, on tomorrow, amen, will be ladies' Bible study. Amen. The ladies will be getting together. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Also, amen, the ladies are going to start reading, amen, in the book of Esther tomorrow together. Amen. All the sisters united together. Amen. And the way they do it through the app or through the text messaging, remind, amen. And as they read, hallelujah, when you get a revelation, just send that revelation straight through remind, and it comes straight to my wife's phone, amen. And those that really speak to where we at right now, she'll post it on the Sisters United website, amen. Glory to God. Also, this Monday, the men will be getting together for men's group. Amen. Come on, men. Hallelujah. That'll be at the Pine Street location. And so God is good. Amen. And not only are the men meeting, amen, but we too are going to be reading together. We're going to be reading the book of Daniel together, amen. Come on, man, give the Lord some praise. Hallelujah. And the woman of God started this, first lady started this, and I was, and not me, but one of the brothers came and they said, Pastor, if the lady's reading with first lady, why can't we read too? You know what I'm saying? You know what I'm saying? But with my little phone, man, it don't remind me of nothing. It barely remind me when it called. You know what I'm saying? But we figured out a way, amen, to get me on that through my iPad, amen, which my iPad is not hooked up to internet and all that. Hallelujah. With Google and all that. But it can do remind. And so what we're going to do, man, we're going to read the book of Daniel together. We start tomorrow in chapter 1, amen? And we're going as you read and you get revelation, amen, I want you to send that to me on reminder. I'm going to be reading y'all revelations, and we'll try to post that up on the Philadelphia website through James Malvo, amen? You send it to me. I'm going to read it. If it's where we are right now, I'm going to send it to Malvo, and we'll post it. But, hallelujah, I just think it's awesome that we can fast together. We can pray together, and we can study the word together. Amen. Hallelujah. And I believe the way it works, we'll do Daniel chapter 1 through like 5, I believe it is. We'll do it Monday through Friday. Got to take off on the weekends, but that don't mean you stop reading your word. Go ahead, read something else. Amen. But we'll just do it Monday through Friday. Amen. And we'll see what the Lord does. I just remember when the ladies did Nehemiah, it was such a spiritual bounty that flowed out of that. Amen. And so we're going to try it ourselves. Amen. Let me see what else, saints. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Nursing home ministry today. Hallelujah. Ronnie P. and the nursing home ministry is today. Hallelujah. They want you to get that 145, and I think I heard Magnolia Estates. Amen. And so that is today. Let me see what else. They sent me that with a bunch. Sent me up with a bunch of announcements. Did I cover all of them? You think so? All right. If y'all remember anything, y'all let me know. Anybody remember anything? All right, Pastor, we don't remember nothing. Amen. Well, I think that's all the announcements, and I did the tithes and offerings. All right. Now, who's ready for the word? Amen. Anybody ready for the word? Amen. Amen. All right. All right. Okay, that's something else. That's something else. I just remember. I'm going to share with you a Hebrew nugget. Amen. Then we're going to get to the book of Acts. Amen. Hallelujah. And Brent got all of this like last minute. And so we're going to work with him as he worked with us. Amen. Because usually when he get it last minute like that, he's working while I'm talking. Amen. And so I praise God for him and that crew that's back there. I give him a hard time, but I praise God for him. And I'm not saying I'm going to stop giving him a hard time. I'm just saying I praise God for you. All right. Listen, we've been talking about the Ashkenazis. Amen. And those who have taken the identity of the true Hebrews, amen, and it's in direct correlation to the scriptures, because the book of Revelation said that there would be, amen, people who say they are Jews but are not. And that's the time that we live in, y'all. That's the scripture. And so we've been giving you a lot of different reasons of, amen, why they're not the biblical Israelites of the Bible. They don't even call themselves that, amen. That's a hint right there. But also we've been showing you a bunch of information on how, amen, the so-called African Americans, the blacks, amen, and those that's in the Caribbean, amen. We even include the Latinos, amen, that these are the true Israelites of the Bible, amen. So this morning we're going to continue with that, and I'm going to talk a little bit about, amen, another reason why the Ashkenazis are not the people. Amen. We told you that all the major movie industries are controlled by the Ashkenazis. We went even as deep as the major TV companies. Amen. NBC, ABC, CBS. Amen. All of the music companies, that's major, controlled by them. We even showed you last time how, amen, they started pornography and they control the pornographic industry, amen, in the world. Hallelujah. And you say, Pastor, how does that prove to us that they're not the people? Well, you got to look at what all of that stuff is. It's perversion. It's filth. It's putting out an anti-God message. is not leading the people of the world to God, is leading them away from God. And so with the help of my little wife, amen, over these past few weeks, amen, we took a look at all of the actors and the actresses that they hire for big roles, amen, in movies. Some of the people that we like to go pay our money to go see, amen. And when we pay our money to go see, we're not only supporting these anti-God, Talmudic, amen, Luciferian, synagogue of Satan people and companies, amen. But when we go see these famous actors and actresses, amen, we support and undergird, amen, an anti-Christ industry and world system. I'm going to show you, amen, some of these actors, amen. I might have two actresses on there, but we couldn't really get the pictures of the actresses because when you go to Google search it, they so vile and defiled, amen. I can't even get on there and look at it, you know what I'm saying? I don't want to see nobody in no nightgown or no bathing suit or nothing like that. Hallelujah. You see, because if you allow that stuff to get on you, that quenches the spirit in you, that quenches the anointing. And so we got some men that can just look at that, amen, and then wonder why there's no anointing flowing through them. Purity brings power, amen. So you shouldn't want to look at a woman in a nightgown and all that, in underwear, all that. That's not going to do no good for you. That's kryptonite to you, Christian. There will be no unction, amen. So I got a couple of ladies in there, amen, that we could find good pictures for or whatever. But not a lot of them. I'm going to just kind of say their name. Amen. So let's start off. Now, there's over 500 Ashkenazi actors that play major roles. Amen. And I'm not going to go through all of them because we'd be here all morning. But I guarantee you, if you think of a famous actor that you like, I'm talking about 9.99% of the time, 9.99 out of 10, they're going to be Ashkenazi. In fact, people that's in the industry, whether they're black or white, and when I say white, I mean truly European, yeah. Amen, they say that you can't get into the industry unless you are part of this group of people or unless you do things that these people do, right? And you're going to figure out the things they do from the Talmud. I'm piercing the veil right here, y'all. I'm talking about blood sacrifice. I'm talking about homosexuality. I'm talking about all of that. You will not get in unless you're part of that group of people or unless you do the things that them people do, which comes right out of the Talmud. I'm talking about pedophilia. Why you think all that's going on right now and expose me and expose? Let's look at them now. These Ashkenazi actors. Number one, Adam Sandler. Y'all remember him? Yeah. Name a movie. Waterboy. Yeah. You see that? Look how impressionable they have impressed their faces on their mind. Now listen to me. You not only should look at the actors I'm going to talk about, but think about their movies. Think about the message of the movies. Think deeply what the movie do in the kingdom of God. Because a lot of the movies that they act in, if you go back and research, amen, they have, as though it were, hallelujah, an unchristianizing effect. Amen. Through either perversion or atheistic, evolutionary, Darwinian ways. All right? I'm going to name some other ones. I don't really know them, but y'all might know them. Adam Brody. Adam Arkin, A.V. Goda. I don't know who that is. Alicia Silverstone, Ashkenazi. Anybody know a movie? Clueless, good job. And a whole bunch of movies too. Ashkenazi, you don't get in without being part of their people. Ali Sheedy, I don't know who that is. Amanda Bynes, Amanda Peete. Amen. We can't put their pictures up. Andrew Dice Clay, for the old schoolers. But you remember how filthy his mouth was? Ashkenazi. Anthony Heald. Anton Yelkin. Barbara Streisand. You? Ben Barnes, Ben Stein, Ben Stiller. You don't get it. It's a family affair. All right? Black people talking about they ain't getting no Oscars. No, you ain't gonna get no Oscars. Because you don't belong in that anyway. Ooh! Unless we do our own companies, our own movies, own awards. Our European brothers should join us too. Black and white entertainment, we call it. You know, because they're not letting us in, is what I'm telling you. They're as much of an enemy to us as they are to the white man. Come on. All right? Beth Midler. Yeah. Ashkenazi. Billy Crystal. Ashkenazi. Bob Saget. Now, if you can guess him, Full House. That's right. That's right. Brad Garrett, Cameron Mayhem, Carrie Fisher. I'm not going to put a picture up there because you can't. It's hard to find a good picture these days of her. The one that just passed away? What she played in? What character? Princess Leia. Ashkenazi, baby. Ashkenazi. I'm trying to reveal something to you. Charlotte Ray, Corey Feldman, Corey Haim. My wife have hit the Three Stooges. Was it one of them or all of them? All three of them. All that. All right? Let me see if you can guess this picture. Daniel Radcliffe. Who's that? Oh, yeah. Now, what is this movie's portraying? Witchcraft. Sorcery. Black magic. I'm trying to show you something, man. Trying to show you something. You know? I can't even pronounce David Duchovny. I don't watch too much TV no more. Deborah Messing, Doris Roberts. You know? I got one we might know. Dustin Hoffman. Anybody know a movie? Rain Man. What another movie? Tootsie? Somebody said. Meet the Parents. Amen. Which a lot of that, the cast on Meet the Parents, all Ashkenazi. All of them. You would never know. You're just watching that. You go and spend your money on that thinking. Going to Redbox, spend your money on that. If you spend your money on black, on Christian, on Hebrew, even white, spend it on white. But don't spend it on that. Right? Elliot Gould, Emmy Rossum, Fran Drescher, Frank Oz. Who's this? Gene Wilder. Oh, yeah, man. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. George Burns. Oh, God, you devil. Remember that old movie? Why would you ever call God a devil? Unless you got a message. Goldie Hawn. Gwyneth Paltrow. Harry Connick Jr. All Ashkenazi. That's just the ones I can read. Listen, there's a list of 500 of them. Most of the ones you like. And I'm going to tell you, I don't mean to be like that. You can tell by the look when you start to know they look. Harrison Ford. Say it ain't so. Indiana Jones. What's that other movie? U.S. Marshal. No. Which one? Air Force One? Yeah. What's that? Fugitive. Air Force One. Yeah, that's your boy. That's your boy. You think he can fight and everything. That's number one. That's acting. I'll put him against John Mark any day. And number two, he's an Ashkenazi. The faces you have grown to love and trust are part of a system to unchristianize our community. You know? Jack Black. Yeah. He real funny. Y'all just laugh looking at him. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Jason Alexander. Jerry Seinfeld. And was it Kramer? Yeah. You ever heard Kramer talk about black people? You ever heard Kramer go off? And you think, man, Kramer wrong for that? Nah. Just Google blacks in Israel and do a YouTube and you're going to see how they all feel about it. Maybe don't do that today. You're going to lose the word. Amen. What does that mean? We got to move on? Okay. Praise the Lord. Ben Stiller. Woody Allen. Joan Rivers. Winona Ryder. Katie Sagal. Paul Rudd. Rena Soffer. Roseanne Barr. Yeah, yeah, yeah. You see what kind of personality that is? See what kind of personality that is? Sarah Jessica Parker. What's she play on? What's Sex in the City? What? Am I tripping? I'm crazy? Nah. I'm revealing the biggest conspiracy, the biggest identity theft, the biggest motions and movements of the devil in our time. That's what we're exposing. And unless you know that, and you're not ignorant of his devices, you're going to keep watching them and watching their stuff and allowing your children to put their pictures on your wall, on their wall, and allowing your children to want to be like them. Amen. Here's the last one to make you laugh. Go fall back as Rodney Dangerfield. No respect. No respect. And that's what they're doing to the other races of men on our planet. White, black, Latino, Oriental. They running the world. And we're going to get deep into the financial underpinnings of their, hallelujah, rule of the world. They're running it financially through entertainment and media. And they're running it spiritually. And we know they're not the people because look at the world is spiritually. You see? When the wicked are in power, the people mourn. When the righteous rule, the people rejoice. Saints of God is another evidence that they're not the people. Jesus said, you shall know them by their fruit. And that's some bad fruit, my friends. In these last days, there's a group that say they are Jews, but are not, but are the synagogue of Satan. I'm going to ask you, saints, who the people? And don't you ever forget them. Don't you ever forget them. Let's look at Acts chapter 5 and verse 17. We're going to get cranked up. Hallelujah. I'm going to try to really work on getting y'all out of here, man. We've been running into second service. And just got to work on my time. Hallelujah. Acts 5:17, we're going to start reading. I want to ask y'all how the fast going. The fast going all right? Yeah. Hallelujah. Anybody hungry? Anybody been tempted with food? All right. For those Daniel fasters, anybody tired of salads? Hallelujah. For those ones that's not doing Daniel, would anybody like a salad? Amen. Anyway. Y'all keep on pressing, keep on going. Remember, your fast is unto the Lord. You can do what you want, when you want to do it. Amen. Just make sure it's unto the Lord. And do your best not to break a vow and break a promise unto God. Amen. Don't overpromise. Keep it low. Amen. Hallelujah. We want to be a people that underpromise but overperform. Amen. That's what we want to be. Amen. And so we got one Sunday down. This is 1 week. We got two more weeks left. And you can eat on Saturday or you can eat on Sunday, you know, whatever you want to do, you know. But next Sunday is going to be another day. But by the time we come that next Sunday, Taleo. You understand what I'm saying? Taleo. And we got some ideas, amen. Thursday prayer has been so anointed. Since the people of God fast, and it's an open heaven, amen. Even after the fast, we might try to issue out a little word, asking the people of God to do a little fast every Thursday. You know what I'm saying? Every Thursday, that'll be our church's fast day. And you could do it how you want. You could fast and do vegetables. You could fast and say, I'm just eating filet mignon. I'm just eating steaks. But whatever you want to do, but I just noticed such a liquidity of prayer, just a smoothness, you know. And for those that come and fast with us on Thursdays, amen, we thinking about feeding y'all on Thursdays. Amen. Amen. Long time ago when we used to do Bible study, Lynn, remember when we used to eat together? We used to break bread together? I think Thursday nights, amen, we come to prayer from 6 to 7, from 7 to about 7:45. We'll try to prepare something for y'all, amen, and get y'all something to eat, amen. Ain't going to be nothing expensive now. I'm going to tell you what you're not going to do, all right? But we're going to get with the meals ministry and talk with y'all and see if we can put some. My wife will be in communication with some of y'all and some that's not even on the meals ministry that we know that can burn, all right? You know, we're going to get with you. G-Money, you on the list, amen? Primetime on the list, amen? We got a few on the list. Hallelujah. Glory to God. All right, I think that's about it. Got a lot going on, though. All right, let's go. Acts 5:17. The Bible says, then the high priest rose up, and all they that were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation, and laid their hands on the apostles, and put them, the Bible says, in the common prison. But the angel of the Lord by night opened the prison doors and brought them forth, and said, go stand and speak in the temple to the people all the words of this life. And we'll stop right there for time. God, we thank you for your word. We thank you that your word, hallelujah, sanctifies us and gives us life, and heals us. Now, Father, all of the benefits of the word, we pray that you'd send your word out, that it would not return void, but accomplish the purpose for which you sent it out to do. Save, heal, bless, edify, set free. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Saints, it's been a little while since we've been in the book of Acts, and so I'm going to just kind of let you know where we were, amen. In the book of Acts chapter 5, if you remember, Ananias and Sapphira, amen, lied to God. And they wound up being smitten by God. And when they were smitten by God, the people saw it. And it brought great fear upon the church, great reverence upon the Lord and the things of God when they saw what happened to Ananias and Sapphira. This fear resulted in a purity. People didn't want to play with God. They just wanted to live right before God. Amen. And anytime you have purity in a church, purity brings power. Amen. Because God is always looking for a clean vessel to pour his power into. Amen. Whenever you clean yourself up, amen, whenever you, through the power of the Holy Ghost as well, go through the cooperation of the sanctification process, amen, you and God team up and you get yourself clean and you purify yourself, amen, God's going to send his power down, his virtue, his dunamis down to use you, amen. And this purity and power is exactly what fell upon the people of God in the early church. We notice that signs and wonders began to happen in chapter 5, amen. And it was so much power that even the shadow of Peter was healing folk, amen. And the gospel began to go out. And the Bible says that every day more and more people were being saved and added to the church. And really, not just added to the church, but believers were added to the church, amen. And so we saw, hallelujah, fear. We saw purity, and then we saw power. Extraordinary, miraculous gifts, but power in preaching, power in the gospel presentation, amen, which resulted in a revival with people being added to the kingdom, amen. This is what we saw, hallelujah, in chapter 5. The last sermon we preached was the shadow of Peter. And we had 3 points in it. And we talked about how the power was moving so much in the church that people in Jerusalem began to bring forth the sick. They heard about the church and the healings that was going on, amen. And people began to bring their relatives, hallelujah, in the streets, amen, and just lay them down in the streets so that they could be healed by the disciples. Secondly, hallelujah, we noticed in our last sermon that, once again, the shadow of Peter was healing people. And we noticed that God can do miracles, amen, hallelujah, in extraordinary ways, handkerchiefs and anointing oil. And as we see charlatans misusing this thing, we can't say, well, God don't heal through that. No, God healed through extraordinary means. Amen. You got some people that's going to try to skin the sheep, fleece the flock. Amen. But God is healing through extraordinary means. And also unclean spirits were being cast out. That's the example of the power that was being operated in when the church got pure, when the church began to fear Almighty God. Listen, this morning, we pick up in verse 17, amen. And the title of the message this morning is persecution. Somebody say persecution. Persecution. That's right. And we're probably going to talk about it for like maybe 3 weeks or something like that, you know, hopefully, maybe two. But at the most 3 weeks, we'll talk about persecution with the help of the good Lord. And we'll have 3 points this morning. Number one is rose up. Number two, the high priest and the Sadducees. Number three, indignation. And so let's begin right away just setting up this sermon series on persecution. Let's start off with our first point, rose up. The Bible says in verse 17, if we can just read it, then the high priest rose up and all they that were with him, which is the sect of the Sadducees, and were filled with indignation. I love the way verse 17 starts. It says then, you see? And remember, then is a word that represents a sequence of events and when something happens after another. Amen. A, then B. Amen. And so we see the then here. The then is persecution. And what God wants us to remember is what happens immediately before the persecution. What happens immediately before the persecution is, just like we said, is the fear of God, a pure church, a powerful church moving with signs and wonders, and people getting saved, delivered, and changed. Whenever you have a church that fear God, a pure church, a powerful church, and people getting saved and delivered, hallelujah, verse 17 tells us, then persecution is going to come. Anybody hear me up in here? That's the scripture. Now, that's the scripture. Then persecution is going to come. All right? So, yes, yeah, saints, it's good to be a pure church. It's good to be a powerful church. But don't be a church that's pure and powerful and think you're not going to be attacked. Amen? Anybody hear me up in here? All right? It's like in sports, when you got a player on a team that's doing damage, amen, are you just going to let that player run for 1,000 yards in the game? Or will you allow your team to focus in on him? Listen, we got to stop this dude. If we stop this portion of their team, amen, we can win the game, or we can stop them from getting the first down. So in basketball, amen, they put double coverage on somebody. In football, amen, they got a person assigned to them, amen. Amen. Well, the same thing in the church. In the church, when you got Christians that's moving in purity and power, amen, I'm trying to tell you that the devil going to double cover them. Anybody hear me up in here? The devil going to double cover them. And it's not just individual Christians. When you have a church, amen, because not every church is moving in purity. Newsflash. Not every church is moving in power. Not every church, amen, is redeeming the lost. Amen. Some people just come into church and they're going through the motions, but nothing is happening. Nobody getting saved, nobody getting changed. Amen. How many people used to belong to a church like that, just going through the motions, but everybody's still just living the way they was living? All right. If it's a church like that, no persecution ain't going to happen. All right. The devil say, hallelujah, our front folk can handle that. You know what I'm saying? We don't need a blitz package. We don't need nothing. We don't need a double cover. Hallelujah. We got them. In fact, you don't need to cover them at all. They're going to miss the shot. Just go ahead and let him take the open shot. In fact, foul him. Put him at the line. He can't shoot a free throw. All right? All right? But the churches that's moving, and there's plenty of them around the nation, and we praying that we one of them. Lord, if you're doing in this season, if you're saving in this season, don't do it without us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. When you got that, when you have that, amen, we can expect that the devil, amen, hallelujah, being a master tactician, a strategist, he's going to move some things around to try to stop that purity, to try to stop that power. Amen. Let me lay it out for you. Subpoint A, pure churches and pure Christians, amen, will be persecuted. Yes, if you're trying individually to keep it real with God, if you're trying individually, if you're trying to keep it real as a church, trying to do the right thing, you can expect that Satan, his system, and his people who are under his control, they will respond to you with persecution. All right? We can get a word on this from 2 Timothy chapter 3 in verse 12. Look at it closely. Look how the Bible says, yea, like saying yes. You didn't think so, but yea. Yes. All that will what? Live godly. What does that mean? Live godly. Live a life, amen, that's trying to conform with God. Amen. Not perfect, but you striving. Amen. You striving for the high mark. Amen. You're going to have your days where you say the wrong thing, do the wrong thing. Amen. Hallelujah. And things might not happen right. Amen. But at least you're trying. Amen. You're trying. You're trying to be like Christ. Amen. If you have that in your mindset, well, you're trying to mirror the master. Amen. When you're trying to mirror the master, all that will live. Amen. And that word live in the Greek is will to live. You seeking to live. It's just in your heart to live godly. How many people is in their heart to live godly? Like I want to do the right thing. Amen. And if you want to do the right thing, if you want to live godly, amen. Hallelujah. Get ready. Hallelujah. Because you will suffer persecution. Oh, yes. You see, I got three claps. Thank y'all, second row. I appreciate that. I got three claps back there. Hallelujah. Yeah, because it's not a word that people like to hear, but it's a word in the church that we need to hear. Amen. Oh, you got to feel me now. You got to feel me. All right. All right. Hallelujah. Now, it says all that live godly, look what it says, in Christ Jesus. All right. Because the only way that you can live godly is being in Christ Jesus. Anybody hear me up in here? All right. Why? Because until you get saved, you cannot mirror the master. Amen. You don't have the capacity to do it. You don't have the mindset to do it. Even the good that you do when you're unsaved is going to be like filthy rags. Even the good that you do unsaved going to have sinful motives and motivations. You go out to feed the poor when you're unsaved, but you're doing it for a tax break. You're doing it as though it were for some glory or somebody. We know a bunch of famous people that do good things, but it's not for the glory of God. It's for the glory of man. Amen? Hallelujah. Until we get saved, everything we do is dirty, made filthy, stained by sin. Why? Because we sinners. It's like a man, amen, that's a mechanic for a job, amen. And he get off of work and he don't get cleaned up and washed and he don't put that lava soap on him, that oil still on his hands. Everything he touch with oily hands becomes oily. Everything you touch with unforgiven, sinful hands becomes stained with sin. That's why the Bible says all that will live godly in Christ Jesus. You can't even live godly. You can't even do right. You can't even do works that magnify God until you're in Christ Jesus. Pastor, how do I get in Christ Jesus? Well, you realize that you're a sinner. You realize that you are dirty. You realize, amen, that even our righteousness to God is like filthy rags. You realize that. And you say, God, hallelujah, I need a savior. I need to be forgiven. Because I know, amen, if I'm a sinner and I die in my sins, the wages of sin is death, I know I'm going to bust hell wide open. Anybody hearing me up in here? So you go to the Savior and you say, Lord, be merciful unto me, a sinner. Lord, save me, a sinner. You know? And you confess him. You open your mouth, you ask him. Not, but you got to ask in faith now. The Bible said, listen, if you don't ask in faith, don't even think that you're going to receive anything from God. Well, Pastor, what I got to believe in? What I got to have faith in to be saved? You got to have faith that Jesus lived a perfect life, that he died on the cross of Calvary, that he was buried in the grave, and on the third day he rose. You got to believe what the word say about him, what the word say about you. And when you put your faith in the right place, and then you call upon the Lord, the Bible says, hallelujah, that everybody, whosoever calls upon the name of the Lord, shall be saved. You see? And when God saves you, he takes you and translates you out of the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his dear son. The Bible says we no longer, amen, hallelujah, in that wrong place, but we are seated with Christ in heavenly places. We are engrafted into his body. We are adopted into the family. Amen. All right? All right? And that's what we talk, that's what we mean when we say in Christos. Because when you get saved, you're taken from a spot and you're put in another spot. Anybody hear me up here? You are put in Christ. That's why the Bible says my life is hid in Christ. All right? And only when I get in Christ will I find my life, because that's where my life is hidden. That's where my purpose is hidden. That's where my, hey, God, all that will live godly in Christ Jesus. You see what I'm saying? That's what it's all about. You see, people can do good out there, y'all, and not be persecuted, no. Ain't nobody mad at this one and mad at that. When they building schools, they doing all kind of stuff. Ain't nobody mad at them. But you let them get saved and be in Christ, and start feeding the poor like the Gates family, feeding the poor and vaccinating, doing all that, and start doing what they do for the glory of God, then the persecution gonna start. You got two athletes then. They both cold. One of them get on the stand after the game and say, man, I'm the king, I'm the best. Another one wanna come with his Jesus shirt on. Another one will come and say, I give God all the glory for what he's doing in my life. Another one will come and testify. Ooh. Which one the Ashkenazi media going to love the most? The one that say, I'm the king. Anybody hear me up in here? Not the one that say, he the king. All that are godly. But where? Godly in Christ Jesus. All right? All right? They shall suffer what? Persecution. Pastor, what is persecution? Persecution is a hostility. You see, a hostility. When someone is hostile to another person, beef, you know what I'm saying? Strife. When someone, it's a hostility, but it's also ill treatment, where we begin to treat you less than, second than. We began to treat other people better than you, all right? Hallelujah. And it's all because, not because of your color, not because of your height, not because of the money you make, but true biblical persecution, they begin to be hostile towards you and treat you bad solely because of your belief in Jesus Christ. You know what I'm saying? And persecution happens on a lot of different levels. You can have a believer married to an unbeliever, sleeping in the same bed, waking up eating breakfast at the same table. But because one has a belief in Jesus Christ, there will be a persecution of the unbeliever on the believer. Anybody hear me? You can have a family where one child out of that family gets saved. And all the rest of the siblings still unsaved. And that sibling will be ostracized, treated like the black sheep, talked about when they're not there. Amen. Anybody hear me up in here? And it's not about anything else, because before that person got saved, they was in the who's who. They was in the clique when they were smoking weed, selling drugs, drinking like everybody else. Everything was all good. But when they put their faith in Christ, that's why you know the gospel is real and the Bible is real, that just because I say I believe in him, now everything changes about me. Now y'all don't want to invite me when y'all eat. Now y'all get on the phone on three-way and talk about what I got going on. You know? Now I'm weird. You know? Yeah. That's persecution. Not only in the family, the extended family. Not only extended family, among friends. How many people done had friends? I mean, I'm talking about Ace Boon Coon. You know how they say that? Me and you will never part. That type of stuff. You just believe in Christ and watch your friends around you. Watch them. All right? That's how you know what we're dealing with is real. That there's a real devil, a real God, a real Savior, a real Bible, a real Holy Ghost. That's how you know it's real. That just when I change my mind, when I stop believing in all of this and I just believe in that, woo, that all of a sudden everything changes and I'm persecuted. Not only friends, but on the job, persecution. You see, we go through it. Not only on the job, in the school, persecution. Not only in the school, in the government, you see, in the government. When they're giving rights to everybody, giving rights to everybody. Transgenders, homosexuals, giving rights to everybody. But we can't read our Bible at school. We can't pray at school. You know what I'm saying? We can't even say what we want. We can't even say that something is wrong according to our beliefs. That girl come out there, the gospel singer, Kim Burrell, I believe her name is. Say a biblical view on homosexuality. Oh yeah, they kick off the Ellen Show, the BMI, which pay entertainers and stuff like that, knocked her off, she can't get her money. You know what I'm saying? Why is that, huh? Because of what she said? No, y'all. It wasn't because of what she said, because what she said came out of a relationship with Jesus Christ. All right? And we're going to talk more about Christians standing up and being who we're supposed to be. That's probably going to come next Sunday. Amen? But what I just want to show you here this morning is that persecution is a real thing. And the reason persecution happens is because of our belief in a Savior. You know what I'm saying? The devil hates God. And because he hates God, he hates all of God's children. You see, you can always tell when somebody hates you by the way they treat your children. Amen? You see what I'm saying? That's how you can check. If you got a question about somebody's loyalty or whatever, just watch the way they treat your children. All right? And if it stay good with the children, then it's good. All right? But some of them, you'll come in there and you watch them, and they be looking at your children with an ugly look. And right then and there, every now and then I try to teach y'all discernment. Right then and there, you know that it's really not the children they hate. But they hate the father of the children, the mama of the children. Anybody hear me up in here? Yeah. That's why stepmamas and stepdaddies have a hard time. Because sometimes they hate that ex. And that child, every time they look at that child, resembles that ex that they hate. You see? When the issue is forgiveness and love, and when you begin to put down what the ex did, you can begin to love that child because that child looks like the ex. Now, let me break that down into a spiritual relationship. You see, we have a Father. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be his name. And our Father has a kingdom that's coming. Amen. And we are his children. We are part of that kingdom. But every time Satan look at us, he see a father that we have that he hate. He can't treat us right because he hate our father. And so persecution happens. Persecution happens. You know? Let's go deeper then. I'm here. We might as well go deeper. What we've been talking about governmentally, amen, business-wise and family and immediate family and friends, what we've been talking about is physical persecution. And really, when the devil hates us Christians, he will unleash physical persecution, meaning that he will use tentacles to act through puppets, all right? Could you imagine like a beast with tentacles? And he just working on your nerves with different people, having people mess with you, amen. But it's all him, amen. It's all him. And that's a natural persecution when he sticks his tentacles out of the spiritual into the natural, into the physical, amen. And he's just using people. But there is also a spiritual persecution where he can make the atmosphere around you not right through snares and darts and anxieties, amen. And he'll do that to God's people, amen. I feel like since we've been on the fast and we've been doing a lot of different things, the marriage ministry been on and we've been doing, you know, word to reveal who he is. He's mad, y'all. And I could feel him mad at me, all right? And so pressure will happen. And you think that y'all late for church and it's all chaotic. You think it's because we waiting on somebody and somebody didn't do nothing. It's that devil, baby. He's trying to spiritually cause an atmosphere that'll mess you up. Look, we was running out of the house so backwards today. I forgot my wedding ring. You know what I'm saying? But I still got that little band. You see his light red. I still got that one. You know what I'm saying? Because the promise is not in the piece of metal. Promises in the heart. You know what I'm saying? So you like that, baby? But what I want y'all to do is like we told the married couples, amen, hallelujah, we fighting everybody else but the enemy. And what I want you to do is realize that anxiety, that stress, amen, I believe the devil changed the temperature in your house, change your body temperature. Because when people get hot, they get aggravated, amen? And y'all fasting, so y'all hungry, y'all hot, hungry. Woo, God! I'm surprised y'all ain't came to blows just yet. But you just got to realize that you have an adversary, you know, who persecutes the church. And he persecutes us solely upon our belief in our Savior and solely because we're part of the family of God. And solely because we are trying to live godly and resemble our Father, which resides in heaven. Give God some glory. Amen. That's that persecution. And Jesus warned us about it in John 15. Look what he tells us. Amen. In verse 18, he says, listen, if the world hate you, know that it hated me before it hated you. But the Lord knows what we deal with. Amen. Because listen, let me tell you, if you think that the devil mad at us, try how he would feel about the only begotten of the Father, the one who is the express image of the Father. We kind of resemble the Father. No. Jesus said, when you've seen me, you've seen the Father. So just imagine, hallelujah, his anonymity, amen, with Jesus. You see? Look at verse 19. If you were of the world, this is what the church needs to understand so bad. If you were of the world would love his own. I pray the church could just take this scripture and tattoo it on our heart. Because we are living in a day, y'all, where the church so bad wants the world to love it. And so we dress like We make music like the world. We talk like the world. We even dibble dabble in sin like the world. The church is so worldly right now. And the church is worldly because it wants acceptance from the world. It wants the world to validate it. It wants the world to say, you okay, y'all cool. Listen to me, Christian. You will never be cool in the world. You will never be able to win the hearts of the world. Listen, if you were of the world would love you. But since you are not of the world can't love you. Because you're from out of this world. You're not of this world. It can't love you. So when I see these lukewarm churches, when you look at them, you can't tell no difference between them and the world. And everybody wearing tights at church. Skimpy, cursing, this, that, everything is just so worldly. You walk in, you don't know if you had a club, a concert, or a church. And it's all to try to get the world to love them. You're fighting a losing battle. Scripture can't be broken. Scripture said it's not going to love you if you're really a Christian. We shouldn't be so focused on validation from them. We're supposed to be focused on validation from him. We should want to hear him say, well done, thou good and faithful servant. Enter into the joy of your Lord. What do you want from the world today? Why do you want the world to look at you? Why do you still want to drive on Simcoe and get some attention from the world? Huh? What are you doing? This world is not our home, saints. We don't belong to it, and it does not belong to us. God have mercy. I'm telling you, man. I'm telling you. That's why, hallelujah, the music company we're not doing a worldly music label. We're not doing a record label that's worldly, seeking the attention of the world, trying to make it big with the Ashkenazis. Nah, we're not doing all of that. For him, by him. Come on, give God some glory. Amen. Jesus says in verse 20, remember, hallelujah, the word that I said unto you, the servant is not greater than his Lord. If they have persecuted me, they might. That's what it's saying. They may be. That's what it's saying. All right. If they have persecuted me, what? They will also persecute you. If they have kept my saying, they will keep yours also. That's the good news behind it. But let's stay on persecution. 21. But all these things will they do unto you for my name's sake, because they know not him that sent me. You see, and that's the reason for persecution. We in two different kingdoms, two different families. We saved, they not. We know him, they don't know him. You know what I'm saying? We actually on two different teams. All right? 22, I'm just going to read it. If I had not come and spoken unto them, they had not had sin. But now they have no cloak for their sin. You see? Jesus came and his purity exposed sin. And that's one of the reasons why they persecute us, not only because of what we believe, but how we act. See, when you go to the job and you don't act like them, that purity brings conviction. And that conviction brings persecution. You know? Because you won't steal, because you won't cheat, because you won't run around on your husband. And they watch you be pure while they live in ratchet. And it make them feel some kind of way. All right? And instead of getting right with God, they want to get even with you. Oh, come on, somebody. But Jesus says in 23, he that hated me hated my Father also. Now, this is a deep saying, because what you need to understand is when they hate us, they're not really hating us. They're hating Jesus. And when they hate Jesus, this verse tells us they're not really hating Jesus. They're really hating God, God the Father, Yahweh. Anybody hear me up in here? So when persecution comes, realize, amen, hallelujah, it's not really you after. It's not really you that's the target of the persecution. The devil is after God. He's been after him since the fall. Amen. And he's going to stay after him until that final battle. Hallelujah. In Megiddo. Hallelujah. That final battle when the great white throne come down and he's cast into the lake of fire forever. You see? Hallelujah. Look at it here. Look at 25. We got to move on. Time passed so fast. But this coming to pass that the word might be fulfilled that is written in their law. Hated me without a cause. You see? All right. Here's the caveat, saints. And I'm going to stop when it's time to stop. Don't worry about the time. Here's the caveat. If you are living godly, pure, trying persecution. The caveat, if you're a Christian but you're lukewarm, you're not living godly, you're not striving for holiness, don't worry about everything that we just said. Don't worry about it. Put your earbuds in. Because if you're not striving for holiness and perfection and godliness, you will not be persecuted. You will not know what all the fuss is about. You got people in the room amening, but you're like, I never had no trouble. All right? Two things could be going on. Number one, you're not part of the kingdom of light yet. All right? Because Satan don't cast out Satan. Anybody hear me in here? Satan don't fight himself. If you ain't never experienced persecution, it's because, number one, it's a high probability that you are not saved, born again, adopted into the family of God just yet. All right? That's a high probability. Secondly, you can be saved. Now, I'm going to say that this probably applies to the status quo of Christendom right now. Say that in English, Pastor. The current church. This applies to the current church. This second reason I'm going to give it applies to the current church. Some of them may be saved, but they show not godly. In fact, they're worldly. You could feel it when you shake their hands in the spirit. It's a spiritual filth that's on them. You could feel it. You could feel it on them. You could see it on them. From what they watch on TV, what they listen to, amen, the way they dress, amen, everything. What they do, what they allow, what they okay with, worldly, right? And a worldly church is not a persecuted church. Because Jesus says, if the salt has lost its flavor, and a lukewarm Christian has lost his flavor, he's not salty no more. And Jesus says, that salt with no flavor is good for nothing. Just imagine if you went in the cabinet and you picked out some seasoning, but the seasoning ain't got no flavor. Meaning that you experience a time you put that, you season, I better stop talking about food, but you season that stuff real good as best you can. You know what I'm saying? And then you go to eat that, and it's bland. Now, it might happen once, fool me once. But if you keep putting that old season all on there, and what you gonna do with that bottle of season? You want to be a throw-out Christian? You want to be a throwaway Christian? Persecution is usually a sign of purity, is evidence of godliness. You want to find somebody that's trying to live after God? Look for the persecuted. All right, let me give you another one, B. Hallelujah. We're going to stop with B. Powerful churches in the Lord. Now, of course, it's in the Lord. Ain't no church powerful on its own. Powerful churches in the Lord and powerful Christians in the Lord will be persecuted. Let's just talk about it. Because it's not only purity and godliness that'll get you on the persecution track, but it's when you're operating in power. When I say power, I mean God's power. I mean that God's power is flowing through you. I mean, you doing things that you should not be doing. You don't have the intellect. You don't have the monetary. You don't have, amen, the family name. You don't come from that neighborhood, amen. But when people look at your life, they see the power of God operating in your life. Amen. From your prosperity, your favor, amen. Maybe your spiritual giftings, amen, that come out, whether you preach, teach, or you worship, or you lay hands, amen, or you administrate, whatever it is. But you operating, amen, not in the ordinary, but in the extraordinary. Amen. When that happens, amen, you get on Satan's radar. Amen. You get on Satan's radar. When you begin to operate in that other category, the extraordinary category, you show up on Satan's radar. Like, look, I'm telling you, everybody else, the radar is flashing and nothing's showing up. And there you go, laying hands, are you preaching, are you administrating, and you being used by God to build up his kingdom and souls getting saved. And all of a sudden, as that radar passes, it goes, boop, 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 boop. You done popped up on the radar, all right? Pastor, you making up stuff. No, let me show you a scripture. You see, in Acts chapter 19, verse 15, the sons of Sceva was casting out devils. But they wasn't on the radar. They wasn't even saved. So when they go to cast out a devil, they say, we adjure you in the name of Jesus, the one Paul preaches. The one Paul preaches. The one Paul knew. Paul's master. Paul's savior, Paul's redeemer, Paul's healer, Paul's provider. Hey, God, we command you to come out by that Jesus. The evil spirit answered and said, Jesus I know, because Jesus is on the radar. And Paul I know, because Paul is on the radar. But look what the devil said, but who are you and beat the ball out of their clothes? You understand what I'm saying? What I'm saying is that you can move in the extraordinary so much, amen, that you could be known in hell. You could be known in hell. You could be known in hell. When the devil do his Monday morning meeting, amen, he talking about you, amen. When he do his Monday morning meeting, he say, all right, okay, this is how it's going in Lafayette, amen. Well, what are we going to do about Minister Duck? What are we going to do about Noel? What are we going to do? What are we going to do with Brother Nolan, who's being blessed left and right everywhere? What are we going to do? They're operating in the extraordinary. I heard about that big old house. Glory to God. Listen, they operating in the extraordinary. What are we going to do with them? We better stop them, because if they keep operating in the extraordinary, other lost folk going to see their life and say, I want to be and do what they're doing. Whatever they're doing, Lord, whatever you're doing, and they like, don't do it without me. So the devil, hey, God, the devil got to call a meeting. Huddle up. Don't you dare let this dude keep getting blessed. Don't you dare let this person keep being anointed. Don't you dare let this thing keep working like that. No. Huddle up. We got to call a double coverage. We got to call a full court press. We got to jump them. We got to throw them off. We got to persecute them. Amen. Because when they being lifted up, hey, God, and they reflecting the glory and the power of God. Amen. Let your light shine before men so that they might see your good works and glorify the Father which is in heaven. Satan don't want nobody glorifying the Lord. So he got to keep you down, keep your light out, keep you low, keep you broke, keep you poverty, keep you not operating in your giftings and your callings. That's where he want to keep you. Because if he keep you there, you don't get no attention. And if you don't get no attention, God's kingdom don't get no attention. I'm trying to. Hey! I'm revealing to you the devil's tactics in 17. Because some of y'all in the spirit, orders done came from heaven. That it's your season to be lifted up and blessed. Nobody light a candle and put it under a bushel. But he about to take your candle, light it, and put it on a candle stand so it can give light to the whole room. Hey, this little light of mine, I'm going to let it shine. You see what I'm saying? And the little children say, won't let Satan blow it out. You see, because that's what Satan want to do. He wants to, he don't to be glorified. You see, that's his old job. His old job was to glorify the Father. He was a worshiper in heaven. Until he, hallelujah, pride was found in him, until iniquity was found in him. And he was kicked out. He lost his first estate. And so his job now is not to give glory to the Most High, but he's trying to steal glory, take glory from the Most High. He want all the glory, you see? And your life, if done right, and the power of God flowing through you, all right? It can bring glory to God. And Satan don't want that, all right? So when you start doing extraordinary things and the power start working out, amen, back to our original premise, amen, you begin to show up on the devil's radar. Bloop, bloop. He said, wait up, God getting some glory somewhere. He said, wait up. I see in PCA, God getting some glory somewhere. I'm seeing in Philadelphia ministry, amen. I see in Lafayette, there's a church that's giving him glory. I see in the nursery, they're giving him glory somewhere. I see in a 12 group, they're giving him glory. I see a husband and a wife, they're working on one accord and they're building some things and some businesses coming. I see them giving, hey, the devil say, hold up. Something showed up on the glory meter. You see what I'm saying? And you see me? I want to be known in hell. I want to be a big old blot on this glory meter. Hallelujah. I want when the meeting starts, he said, well, hallelujah, we got some new people getting up in the glory meter, but we got the same old Omar Tebow is on the glory meter again, giving God the glory. Can anybody do anything? You see what I'm saying? I want to be one of them players, they triple cover, double cover. One of them players where they say, he going to get his. You understand what I'm, you know the one you can't cover, he going to score 30 points. And not just me. I want that for you. When you understand that, hallelujah, listen, after your greatest accomplishments, sometimes come your greatest persecutions. Right after the power flowed through you the most, after you prophesy, after you preach, after you teach, after you worship and people fall out, after you publish that song, after you publish that book, after that ministry, hey, God, when you are at your best, hey, at the top of your game, you're going to show up on that glory meter, and that's when persecution come in. I tell you this not to scare you. I tell you this to prepare you. Because if you know it's coming, you can defend yourself. If you know it's coming, you cannot let him blow your light out. If you know it's coming, you can stay shining. If you know it's coming, you can stop blaming husband and wife and children and everybody else that's around you. It's not them. It's not them. It's Satan. You just showed up for a meter. Anybody hear me up in here? Listen to me now. When you found that sweet spot in your Christianity, the devil wants you out of that spot. People getting saved, healed, delivered. And I have in my notes, because individually to me, as a pastor, when I found out about the imposters in the true Hebrew, when I found that out, you know? And then when I released, all right? I'm telling you, my color must have turned on the glory meter. I went from green like everybody else to red, orange, and all kind of stuff. Because let me tell you, the attacks multiply. And you can tell when you done hit the devil where it hurt. You can tell. You know what I'm saying? When you done caught him at a weak spot, or you done came upon something he don't want you to know about. Hey, God. Because he gonna react. You know what I'm saying? It's like in boxing when you hit a man where he weak at. Oh, he gonna do some things that kind of, it's like in football when you done found the weak place in the defense. You see what I'm saying? And I think in my spirit, we tapped into something. And because we tapped into something, persecution arose like we never had persecution in the history of hell. Now, what he wants from us, the wine of coal, is for us to tap into it, see resistance from the dominions, from his minions, and back away. But what you do when you tap into it and the glory fall, you say, I'm not backing up. I'm walking in, because where you at and where you don't want me to be, devil, that's where I want to be. Let me in here. I ain't scared of you, for greater is he who's within me than he that works within the world. Come back here.
You got something to say, Brother Joe?
No.
All right. Wherever the devil don't want you at, that's where you want to be at. Anybody hear me up in here? So sometimes you're going to come upon resistance there. You know? And if we're not diligent, if we kind of like scaredy cat, amen, we back away. And a lot of the times, our purpose and our destiny is going to be in that place that's blocked up by the devil. It reminds me of David. You see, before David even got to Goliath, the devil blocked the way. His brothers and everybody began to persecute him and attack him. Why don't you go take care of them little sheep you got, David? You don't belong here. You just, it's your pride. And so the way is blocked up for David. But David didn't allow that, amen, to stop him from meeting his destiny. He looked beyond the distraction, the deterrence, and he saw the giant in the valley. He looked beyond deterrence and saw destiny. Woo! And when you get to a place, when you mature, you're going to look beyond deterrence and you're going to see destiny. And you're going to want destiny more than deterrence. And deterrence will never stop you. You will have a grit about yourself. Hallelujah. When you're trying to get somewhere and the truck breaks down, don't worry about it. We're going to get there. Let me call somebody. Let's do something, because I got to be there. If you're trying to stop me, that means I got to get there. If the engine light come on, if I get a flat, if the business don't work the first time, if the mortgage don't go through the first time, if they don't approve it, God have mercy. We got a church, amen. Hey, God, that walk up to closed tombs and turn around. When the church was born from rolling stones off of closed tombs, where there's Lazarus or where there's Jesus, come see the place where the Lord lay. I want to be known in hell. In 1 Peter 4:12, we're going to end off on this scripture. I just got on point number one, but that's good. I'm not pushing. We're going to do this little point, and we're going to wrap it up. You know what I'm saying? And we're going to come back next Sunday. You see? We're going to do that. They've been on me. I got to work with my time. You know? But in 1 Peter, amen, chapter 4, and this is the message that I have for you today. Beloved, think it not strange concerning the fiery trial, which is to try you, as though some strange thing happened unto you. What you're going through right now in your life is not because God has forsaken you. Hallelujah, it's because you're on the right road, baby. Listen. Hallelujah, it's about to happen, amen. You are right where you need to be, amen. You got your hand on it, amen. Hey, God. Don't get discouraged. Don't get dismayed. You got to stand. You can't quit. Don't think it's strange, as though some strange thing happened unto you. He says, but rejoice, inasmuch as you are partakers. That means you share. You share You are partners sharing in Christ's suffering. And here is the allegory here. The analogy. You see, Christ had a cross to go through before he got his crown. Woo-hoo-hoo! He had a cross to go through before he got his crown. We got a lot of Christians running from crosses, and that's why you never got your crown just yet. Hey! The only way to be seated at the right hand of majesty is to go through a place called Calvary. And you're going to go through it individually. You're going to go through it in your marriage. You're going to go through it in your business. You're going to go through it sometimes in your health. You're going to go through it in your mind. But listen, hallelujah, you got to be like Jesus, considering the joy that was before him. Hey, he pressed on. Hey, God, he pressed on through the cross. That's what we got to be. You press on. Hallelujah. Weeping may endure for a night, but joy comes in the morning light. And listen to me, listen to me. Everything that the devil throw at you, the Lord will repay you and restore you at least double for your trouble. You just gotta hold on. You will recover it all, and he will restore all the years that the locusts have stolen. But you gotta learn how to press and how to not give up. You think a soldier is made on an easy battlefield? The greatest soldiers that received the greatest accolades and received the greatest rewards sometimes go through the most hardships. And that's who it is, as our example, Jesus. 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 The Bible says, count it all joy when you endure manifold temptations, tribulations, and suffering. Count it all joy. Where it's coming from and how it's coming. We know even if it's from Satan, count it all joy. Count it all joy. Count it all joy. I'm telling you, count it all joy. It's going to get greater later. 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 You talk to anybody who has come to any resemblance of arriving someplace. After they show you the mountain, the hill that they stand on successful, they're going to show you the valley they went through to get to the mountain. You see what I'm saying? So let's not run from valleys. Let's not run from trials and troubles and persecution. We meet it head on. Amen. We meet it head on. And next Sunday we're going to come and get deeper into it. Amen. And do this for a few weeks. My question this morning, amen, for you is, hallelujah, are you in Christ? Are you in Christ? Are you in Christos? You see? Because if you are in Christos, this sermon applies to you. Meaning that your weeping is going to turn to joy if you're in Christos. All right? It's the promise. The promise is, in Christos, all things going to work together ultimately for your good. The sad thing is, if you are not saved this morning, you don't have that promise. You don't have the promise that it's all going to turn out all right. You don't have that promise that the weeping will eventually turn to joy. You don't have a promise of better days ahead. Amen. If you're not saved, amen, hallelujah, all you can look forward to is a life of misery on earth and misery in hell. But it don't have to be like that. It don't have to be like that. Our God is a loving God this morning. And he says to the lost, to the wicked, to the sinner, he say, why die? Why perish? Why go through misery? It's not in God's heart to banish you from heaven. It's not in God's heart for you to weep, amen, with no hope. That's not God's heart for you. God's heart for you this morning is that you would have life, and that you would have life more abundantly. If you are here, not saved, you've heard the gospel in this message already. You can be saved as easy as ABC this morning. You just come to Jesus and you admit that you're a sinner. That old mechanic with oil on his hands in the spirit. You just admit that your sins have separated you from God. Hallelujah. And the wages of your sin is death. You'll never get to heaven without being forgiven. Secondly, you believe, Lord, I believe you came, lived a perfect life, died for my sins, and you rose on the third day. Y'all can put that music back. I like that. Rose on the third day. Amen. Believe that with your whole heart. And then you open your mouth and you confess him. And that's what the altar time is for. For us to confess him. To pray and confess him. Listen to me. I'm going to have an altar call. And if there is any doubt whether you know the Lord or not, you come to this altar and we're going to pray with you. Secondly, if you are a Christian and you've been experiencing the heat of persecution, the tentacles of the enemy showing up in your life, in your home, with your family, friends, on the job, you feel it. You feel it. And you need prayer. The altar's going to be open for you too. If you are a Christian and you have fallen into this deception of trying to get the world to love you, trying to impress the world, you're going to come to the altar and I'm going to pray for you. If you are lukewarm, if you're not red hot for the Lord, the altar's going to be open for you and for anybody else that this word has touched in any way. The altar is now open. Come and pray with your pastor. Come and pray. Come and pray. Come and pray. Maybe it's been tough for you and you just don't understand why. But I'm telling you to hold on. There's a bend in the corner. It's about to change. It's about to turn. It's about to turn. It's about to turn. Your life is about to turn. It's about to turn. The turn is here. And what I don't want is that right when it's about to turn, you quit and get off the track. You see, because if that happens, you just got to start all over again. You don't want to just be starting over and over again trouble in your life. We want to get to a place where we are actually victorious over our troubles. There's somebody here, you've been wandering in the wilderness of trials for 40 years. And I'm here to tell you there's a promised land waiting for you. God's just waiting for you. Waiting for you to cross your obstacle, your Red Sea. Hey, just cross it. Just cross it. We're going to pray, saints. We're going to pray. We're going to expect God to do something at this altar. We're going to pray first for salvation. Then we're going to pray for everything else. If you can, just bow your head and close your eyes with me. Bow your head and close your eyes. I want you to say, Father, thank you for loving me in spite of me. I admit I've sinned against you, and I'm so sorry. Lord, have mercy on me, a sinner. But I believe your Bible and how it says that Jesus Christ came, lived a perfect life, died on the cross, was buried in the grave, and rose the third day, all so I could be saved. I believe that. And I receive that. Lord, save me, a sinner. Give me a new heart and a new start. Help me to be in the world, but not of the world. Help me to know that you love me. And I don't need the world to love me. Lord, as I go through trials, tribulations, give me strength not to quit. Give me strength not to turn around. Make me a soldier. Give me strength to press through. Come with me. Persecution. Tribulation. Whatever. I'm marching. Straight ahead. For Jesus. Come on, give him glory, somebody. Give him glory. Give him glory. Give him glory. Give him glory. The devil can't beat you. For the victory is already won. But he can outlast you. And he can make you turn away. You just got to stay in the fight. And you win. You win. Just stay in the fight. Okay, if you get knocked down, righteous man falls 7 times, but he get back up. Just stay in the fight. Just stay in the fight. Hallelujah. May the Lord bless you. May he keep you. May he cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and bless you now with peace, with shalom. Y'all can keep that music playing. It's good, y'all. It's good. I pray in the mighty name of Jesus that your week be a blessed week this week, that it be filled up with favor. Hallelujah. In blessings, in prosperity. Let this new year be a breakthrough year for you. A breakthrough year for you and yours. We pray all these things. In Jesus' mighty, wonderful name we pray. And the church say, amen, amen, amen. Love y'all. Be blessed.